Let's continue. So the next topic is the role of cities in the art ecosystem. We have been looking at this subject for quite some time, and I think so we have really the right person to talk about the role of cities for the art ecosystem. So thanks to Oliver Berger. Olivier is based in Canada, is the co-founder with Sophie of a company called Wondeur.ai. Sophie was not able to come due to pregnancy. So Sophie, if you are with us, so big kisses. And so Wondeur is a technological company, data, AI, but I'm sure so you will explain a bit more. And question of time, I leave the floor to you. So listen to that. I think that could be a very interesting tool for cities, for regions that are looking at their strategies around the cultural sector. So that could be useful to develop metrics and tools to support the developments of artists. So,
thank you.
Floor is yours.
I have the speaker, right? Yes.
Buongiorno, good afternoon, everyone. I think there's no better city than Rome to speak about the role of cities in the art ecosystem. I think Rome was called in the first century the eternal city, then it was called the imperial city, then the capital of the world. This is the epicenter of the Renaissance movement, the birthplace of the Baroque style and the neoclassicism style. Throughout its 2,500 years old, the city has projected its immense power throughout the Western world. So thank you for choosing Rome as the place for the conference. So just a little bit of introduction and context about why we're doing what we're doing. We're a company based in Toronto. We call ourselves a research lab. But when we set up the company with my co-founder, Sophie Percival, back in 2018, when we assembled a team of senior researchers from MIT and the University of Toronto, which is, I don't know if you know, the birthplace of the global revolution around AI, was because we had one key hypothesis, is that art is suffering not from a problem of transparency. Transparency is not the main issue, but from a problem of explainability, explaining value, how value is created in the art world. Why do value change? When does it change? And how to project that risk in the future? And this is representing a major problem for every player in that ecosystem, starting from insurance, who can't insure to value at scale, to wealth management, as we mentioned earlier, much of those assets are not managed, to artists who can't strategize their career, to collectors who are not taking risk and always buying on the top end of the market. And the consequence of that is out of the $2 to $3 trillion of assets, most of it is illiquid, most of it is mismanaged, most of it is misinsured, and most of it is not leveraged, i.e. lend against. So our mission right from the get-go has been to build the tools and the foundation for the entire player in the ecosystem to really solve that problem and really unleash the potential of the art world. So the following slide I'm going to share with you today, some of them might surprise you, because there's a lot of preconception about the art world, about how it functions, and who operates in that world. So I just want to tell you the following. It's all backed up by 4 years of research and based on the biggest art database that was ever built. So everything is fact-based based on the analysis that we've done in the past 4 years. So the first thing I want to share with you is data show that the art world is a complex ecosystem. It's actually like a biological ecosystem. And it's intelligent. It's highly structured. And it's self-regulated. We're going to see why in a few minutes. And it relies heavily on collaboration in interdependencies throughout the network. And cities across the world are really the beating heart of, or the beating art of the art world. So to go through it, I'm going to go through three parts, and don't worry, we're going to have time for lunch. The first one is about how cities do contribute to the creation of value. But what I mean by value is the cultural importance of an artist, and the cultural value of the asset value, so to speak. And then I'm going to explain to you how cities collaborate and what does that mean. And then on the third part, we're going to go into what are the tools that exist to really measure and strategize strategies for cities. So the first thing to share with you is the art ecosystem is made of about 30,000 institutions. By institution, I mean commercial galleries, cultural centers, and museums. And all those institutions act as a self-regulated and filtering process. How it works is very simple. You have to imagine that 30,000 institutions have all make independent decisions. Everyone decides to show or not show an artist. Everyone decides independently to collect or not collect an artist. The second aspect is the cultural significance of an artist or the cultural value of the asset of those artists is built not by one institution, by several, dozens, hundreds in some cases. So because all those players are independent in their decision making, a succession of validation is necessary to help an artist create value over time. Then the other aspect is each institution has a different impact on the cultural significance of an artist and the value. You can imagine, you know, the small gallery on the corner of the street compared to the Guggenheim. Every one of them will have a different impact across time and across different group of artists on both sides of the equation, cultural significance and asset value. And the third thing is the power is not concentrated. In the worst case scenario, you know, the mega gallery will have no more than 5% impact on the success or the value of an artist over time. So the preconception that mega gallery make or break an artist is wrong based on the analysis that we've conducted in the past 40 years. And the fourth thing is auction is not a driver of value. It's actually a driver of value for less than 2% of the artists worldwide. For 98% of artists worldwide, auction does not define value. So now let's go back to the city. And within the city, there's an ecosystem in itself. And there are three main players. There are the museum, there are the commercial galleries, and there are the cultural centers or the nonprofit. And what's interesting is each of those three players have distinct behavior and distinct motivation. You know already, commercial galleries want to sell. Museum wants to collect work for a show work for future generation. And then cultural centers have different mission based on the curatorial objective. And throughout our study of about 1,200 cities across the world, we've never seen a functioning ecosystem that didn't have the three components, the three players playing and collaborating accordingly. Because it's a very collaborative exercise. We're going to see in a few minutes through data is you need the play and the interdependence of those three players in order to build a healthy ecosystem. This is a study that we published with UBS a couple of months ago. Really focus on the entirety of the US ecosystem. And it's a simple graph, nothing fancy. What it shows you is, the evolution of artist career going from emerging to star artists, you know, the top 0.5% of the artists worldwide. And what it shows is the proportion of contribution within the show or collections of those three entities, commercial galleries, museums, and cultural centers, varies between 30 to 40% each. You know, 40% cultural centers and commercial galleries at early stage, and then goes down to 30, whereas museums take the lead at 40%. But you see how there's a balance, almost like, and we are within a religious environment, the trio is really sacred in the art world. Now let's dive into the ecosystem of a city. Now we're gonna look at how cities exist within the entire ecosystem. What I'm going to share with you now, and I hope it shows well, is the US. It's just looking at what happened in 2012. The line that you see represents the amount of exchange that is happening between cities across North America. Here you have New York, with a very much linked with a lot of exchange of artists between New York and Chicago, and then especially with cities like, if the clicker works, with San Francisco and Los Angeles, and then you will recognize Miami. This map is just a simple visualization just to see the amount of exchange just for 2022 between cities exchanging artists. Now I'm going to overlay this map with how cities in the US are interacting with cities around the world. And you're going to see that the exchange is quite different. This is the same map with the overlay of exchange. Coming from this side, you have all the exchange between the US cities and Europe. On the left side, you're going to have all the exchange between the Asian cities and the US, and then with South America. And then that represents about 200 cities only. And then we're going to focus again and go into the world dimensions. And what we're going to see about the representation of 800 cities, just 2022, the amount of exchange of artists moving from one city to another across the world, across 800 cities just for 2022. So it's very equivalent to the amount of exchange of goods that you see throughout the world, except we're talking about cultural good. A simple way to summarize what I just mentioned here is when you look at the top 2,700 artists who went from nothing 40 years ago to the top 0.5% artists in the world, you know, on average, they would have been shown within 64 different cities. So the amount of cities that needs to be present in the career of an artist is quite significant. And so by collaboration doesn't mean that voluntarily the cities are going to be collaborating, but involuntarily they are critical in the buildup of cultural significance and the buildup of cultural asset value. Now, let's see what does it mean in terms of data. So, well, we all know, you know, data is about monitoring and strategizing. And so there's a first set of data that we put together. The first one is around cities and institutions. The first one is performance. How good is an institution or a city to select an artist that will grow significantly 3 years after? And then a more precise one, the success rate. How good is an institution or a city to help an artist reach the top 20% high growth artist in the world, or the top 10%, or top 5%? And then you have the risk appetite. What is the propensity of an institution, commercial, nonprofit, museums, or a city to take a risk, i.e. to make a decision to show or collect an artist before any other institution or before any other cities? And the last one, and very important, is the impact. How much every institution has, or every city has, on the cultural significance of an artist or the asset value. And this is something that we measure for about 1,124 cities as of today. And then we had to go down around artist intelligence. You know, the growth, the acceleration, future growth, the propensity to future acceleration, and the overall concept around value for that artist. And then we had to go down at an asset level, which is, if the clicker works, understanding the value within all these dimensions. What is the long-term value, the interesting value? What is the liquidity value, which is very different? And what is the speculative value, which is also a third dimension of value? And what is the future risk on value and the current risk on value? And you will be surprised. You need to understand the past risk on value also for different purposes. So we do this for about, and there's a typo on the presentation, about 1,124 institutions. We do it for about 30,000 institutions worldwide. We do it for about 91-92% of artists born after 1815 worldwide. And we do it as a result for millions of assets, including NFT. We published about a few months ago with our partner, Generali, and with Coria De Sella, I hope I pronounced it well, a small analysis around the Italian ecosystem. And here what you see on the graph is two measures of metrics, the success rate, propensity to take risk of an institution, and propensity to perform, so to speak, the success rate and the risk appetite. And we compare, you know, commercial galleries of Milano with commercial galleries in other cities like New York, Parigi, and so on and so forth. And we did the same with cultural center. What was interesting in this study, it showed that actually the Milano ecosystem is powered by the commercial galleries. The commercial galleries are the one within that ecosystem taking the most risk, having the most success in projecting artists into the future of their career, whereas the cultural centers and the museum were laggards into that world. And when you compare Milano with Paris or Los Angeles, which has been, you know, flying through the roof in terms of center of ecosystem in the past 20 years, you see Los Angeles with an equilibrium in terms of success rate and risk appetite between the museum, the galleries, and the cultural center. So here we were able to analyze the fact that commercial galleries in Milano are alone and doing a fantastic job, have one of the most successful success rate in the world, but they're alone. And for Milano to rise up again and be a center of the art world ecosystem locally and globally, different support needs to happen for cultural centers and museums. Or the report, another report we published with UBS, which was a comparison for US cities, and just looking at the gender gap happening between different cities. What we learned from this exercise is you can't look at the country level, you have to look at the city level, because you're gonna have widespread differences of mini ecosystem in every city. What it tells you here, it tells you that if you're a woman, you better show in New York through a museum, or in LA through a museum, in order for your career to really excel. If you've shown in other commercial galleries or cultural centers or museums throughout other cities in the US, your career will not advance as much as men. So this kind of measurement help, you know, cities, you know, to be strategic in their thinking and thinking about the next population. Or when we published with Deloitte, that was last year, a global index around different metrics that I mentioned earlier. You know, the intent of this index is very simple. Cities already collaborate a lot. They collaborate around sustainable development, they collaborate around, you know, security. You know, once you put numbers into performance, into measurement of the health of an ecosystem, you know, what we hope to achieve is to have cities collaborate, you know, and help each other on different aspects. Once you measure, you can change, and that's really the idea. So as a conclusion, and will give us enough time for lunch, I hope, there are critical questions that can be asked. You know, if you're an insurer, how can you manage the insurance risk at scale? If you're wealth management, how can you bring those assets under management? They're cultural assets, but how can you bring them under management and leverage them? But if you're a city, you know, one of the fundamental questions is, how can you increase your cultural power? And in this age of acrimony and, you know, fraction of the art world, the cultural power is even more important than before. We've had tremendous requests in the US to understand the cultural power of US cities versus Chinese cities, and you see exactly in what mood everybody is. But the other question you can have is a little bit deeper. How do you better allocate funding or policies across the different entities that make a healthy ecosystem within a city? The commercial galleries, the museum, the cultural center. In the case of Milano, maybe commercial galleries shouldn't be treated like a mom and pop shop, and maybe they should be treated as a cultural powerhouse, and as a result, have tax reduction and other incentive for them to help survive. So these are fundamental questions that every city should ask themselves. And lastly, you know, do you have as a city a proper setup to build a future generation of artists? And more importantly, to address the bias that exists. We talked today about gender bias, but not surprisingly, you're going to see a tremendous amount of cultural background biases that exist in every country. And so how do you address those in order to propel the next generation and the future of the cultural power of your cities? We're almost there. Last slide. It's a nice graph. So as a conclusion, you know, actually, you know, when we arrived to this analysis, our team, the first reaction looking at the ecosystem, they say it's beautiful. A lot of them have a background in biology. They found it beautiful and extremely intelligent and self-adjusting system. And it was very surprising. It's not something we assumed it was going to be. But what really came up as well is the extreme interdependence between all players. You can't remove the insurer or the wealth management firms or the collectors or the museum or anyone within that equation. Everyone is interdependent like an organism. And so you need to bring new tools and new system for them to survive, for some of them, and to thrive for a lot of them. And we think this new way of thinking through data is a way to really change the foundation of the cultural and arts economic to really help it to thrive and propel to the next generation. Thank you.
On time. Yes. So if you have questions?
Or you prefer lunch? Yep.
Your assumptions, when you're taking the data that you accumulated to, and your assumptions that you used for, I understand the city interdynamic, but I'm mostly looking at, we're asset managers, so we collect,
yep.
And it seems that your success is based on value, correct? Eventual value
measure.
Of...
It's one measure.
So let's take that one measure.
Yeah.
The assumptions that you made to use that, to gain that value, what were the assumptions that you used?
So there's no assumption, so I'll just give you...
So as an example, yeah. You have a new artist as opposed to a classic. So a classic has if you have a classic piece of artwork, it has a value, it has a mark to market.
Yeah.
But if you have a budding artist coming out from nowhere, you are giving that some type of a value, I assume, or...
Absolutely, so everything is predictive in our model. So the way to see the market, you have 500 artists who have had, in the past 10 years, reached $1 million and above at auction market.
Agreed.
Right? The rest is nothing. Most of the artists
or zero.
Will have no transaction at auction.
Right.
And what we discover is there is actually a mechanic of value creation in the art world. So when you see a price tag of $30,000 at a dealer, it's not coming out of thin air. there's a logic to it. It's not a conscious logic, because usually the gallerist is someone who has knowledge and intuition. But behind intuition, there's actually a mechanism taking place where they look at the CV of an artist, they look at the reputation based on intuition of where the artist has shown, and based on that, we'll create a price, right? Mm. And so when you look at all the prices that galleries will create as a result of that, you see that the same, two different galleries, or X different galleries, having the same access to the same CV will come up with the same price.
So that's the assumption you use.
So no, it's not an assumption, which is very different. This is a fact. This is something that we proved. There's a logic in the ecosystem of how value is defined, or the price tag is put together. It's not an assumption, it's something that is proven, so to speak.
Understood.
Understood. I know. You know, work. If auction was the baseline...
Well, the auction's easy.
Auction is not the baseline. Auction is a liquidity instrument, and that's all it is. And so today, if you're looking for credibility, we're working with some of the biggest insurers in the world, in the US and in Europe, and they use us to optimize insurance to value. So it's the real thing. Working with UBS as well on that, and many others.
One more question, or you want a lunch?
Okay, so let's go for lunch. So let's be back.
Thank you.